Hey, it's Fran. In the lab, again, with a brand new Heathkit. Yeah. Yeah, this is the GC-1006 most reliable clock. I actually got this last year. I think it was like last November. I bought this clock and sat on it. I can't imagine what could have distracted me from building a Heathkit last year. I don't know. It escapes me. I don't know what it could have been, but I'm back on track, and now I have the time, and it's New Year's Eve, so I figured that I would get into this kit and start putting it together. It's sort of a tradition that started with me back in 78 or so, when I did my first Heathkit around New Year's, my GC-1107. And so this clock is in a long tradition. I have this GC-1005 Panoplex clock that I restored a couple of years ago with the help of a couple of really generous viewers who donated some parts to be able to fix that. And I have the GC-1000 most accurate clock, which was just restored a couple of weeks ago. It's running over there in the corner. So this 1006 will be yet another in the family. Interesting about this new Heathkit company, because in preparing to do this build, I wanted to learn about the new company and about, you know, what they're doing and how they're doing it and everything, and is it anything like the old Heathkit? Because the old Heathkit company from way back in yore, and even when it was owned by Zenith in the late 70s, 80s, it still had like a state-of-the-art, you know, assembly line kind of process of being able to put together these elaborate kits from thousands of parts and everything. That so I think if I read that it was actually the reason that Zenith acquired Heathkit was really to acquire their assembly methods of how they're able to put together these really big kits that they were making at the time. And I was really interested to find out if they were still doing that kind of like really vertical integration, because in the old days, Heathkit, they had a top-down, vertically integrated company. They did their own design, and they had their own draftspeople to do all of the line drawings and sketches and stuff for their instructions. They printed their own publications, did their own catalogs. They, you know, they did their own circuit boards, and you know, you could get either a Heathkit built by Heathkit technicians at the Heathkit factory built for you, or you could do the kit. And so it really was kind of like this very 20th century kind of company. But by the time it got into the mid 80s, they just couldn't compete, because they had built this huge company and this huge customer base on the idea that back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, that in a lot of ways it was cheaper to build something yourself rather than buy off the rack, especially if you were buying like test equipment, things like that, that if you bought like a commercial HP, it would be, you know, cost a lot more than building the Heathkit version. But by the time the 80s rolled around, with custom ASICs and microprocessors and all, and the, you know, the rise of computers and PCs, that the hobbyists in the late 80s, they were a lot less interested in building hardware than they were in building software, because video games and video game software and programming had really captured the younger hobbyists. And so Heathkit just couldn't compete. And especially the idea that the really cheap components that were becoming available, and the miniaturization of everything, and the idea of, you know, everything all on one chip, was really making it so that you could go out and buy a completed finished product for less, sometimes a lot less money, than buying the Heathkit version by the time Heathkit was going under. So I wanted to find out if any of this was still going on, and despite all the research I could do, there was just really nothing to find. It's the new Heathkit company is very secretive. They haven't like published any videos or tutorials or tours or anything like that. There's no blog explaining what they're doing and how they're doing it, or who's working for Heathkit, or if they're doing it all in-house, or if they're farming it out. There's just no info. So, you know, and I think a lot of confusion. There was a number of Hackaday articles that were written between 2015 and, I guess, a few years ago about the on-again, off-again public statements coming out from Heathkit about what Heathkit was doing. And I, most I could piece together was that somewhere around 2014-15 or so, some kind of venture company had bought the rights to Heathkit, and I guess got built up some venture capital and planned to bring Heathkit back and promoted that they were bringing Heathkit back, but then they didn't actually bring it back. But somewhere around 2016 or 2015, it was bought by another entity, which currently owns it, and I really wasn't able to find out much more than that. So, it's a complete mystery. Hopefully, maybe we'll hear from Heathkit about what they're planning on doing in 2020, if there's going to be any new kits or anything. I really don't know. So, anyway. But, let's get to this one. Who knows what's going on at the new Heathkit, but they do have a clock kit, and so let's get right into it. All right, well, here it is. The box, like I said, I bought this last year. Okay. Oh, all right. So, congratulations. You have a first production run Heathkit's GC-1006 Most Reliable Clock Kit. So, like I said, I bought this last year. Do not open any kit envelopes yet. That was one of the things they would always tell you in Heathkits. The assembly manual will tell you how to unpack, yada, yada. The manual's personal to you. That's interesting. How could it be personal to me? It has been customized for you. It contains your personal product and account access data. Okay, we'll have to be careful to, I guess, not maybe broadcast that. be sure not to share it with others. Yeah, okay, this will be a little tricky. To start your adventure, take out the manual and turn to page 4. So the components are rows. Well, I don't know. I'm set up for lead solder, so, it's just going to have to be a combination of things. All right. So we got a letter. I'm delighted to be able to say enclosed is your new Heathkit. This is another instantly historic Heathkit. Its predecessor over 30 years ago, Heathkit GC-1005 clock kit, which is operating right up there. Well, the GC-1005... it's a lot more than 30 years ago, because I've got one. One I have up here is, it's like 45 years old. Because I think it was 1972. Was it 1972, the 1005 Panoplex came out, the first ones, like 72, 73, 74? I don't know. Well, it was at least 45 years ago. But anyway, we both followed improved tradition with the 1006. Most reliable clock, your own special patent-pending design, using a microprocessor containing custom Heathkit firmware. So it's a, it's like a Arduino or whatever, microprocessor to provide a wake-up alarm integrated 10-minute perpetual snooze function, a one-button experience, thoughtfully designed, a one-button experience. I guess they're saying everything in one button. I'm not so keen on one buttons to do everything. I'm not so keen on that myself, but I keep it running with a battery, so it's got battery backup. Okay. You'll find the manual meets and exceeds all our historic Heathkit standards for assembly instructions and everyday detail. We've also added modern improvements. One customization your kit may have, the personalization thing. I'll have to take a look at that. If you need to contact us, yada yada, sales number. Thanks again for your enthusiasm, patience, and interest in Heathkit. We truly appreciate your faith and trust in us. Look forward to continuing to deserve it in this way. Sincerely, Andy, President, and the Heathkit team. Oh, all right. So I did a little research. I guess that's Andrew Cromartie. Is the CEO of Heathkit, so I was the only person I could find involved with Heathkit, so there's like no other board members or anything else I could find. So I have to assume that Andrew Cromartie had bought the Heathkit and is, it's obviously a corporation, but he's the only person I could find who's actually got a name attached to Heathkit. But I sure would like to know if any of you, if anyone watching, if you're involved with Heathkit, if you're allowed to talk about it, leave a comment. Sure would like to know more about the new Heathkit company and what's going on over there. Okay. All right, that's the cover. Interesting that they have the artwork with the father-daughter, the daughter working on the Heathkit. So, you know, a lot of women did work on the Heathkits, you know. Girls like science. It's just a fact. Yeah, so taking some nods from the original catalogs, line drawings and such. It's all kind of done like original catalogs. I'm just skimming through the manual looking for the personalization stuff, and I don't see it. Unless it's buried in the interior somewhere, but it doesn't make any sense. But it has like the old artwork, you know, how to bend your leads for resistors, using like tools for, you know, doing stuff like that. I was going to cut to the chase, going right to the schematic. Yeah, it looks like they've got a couple of custom processors. It'd be interesting to pull the chips if they're PICs or, you know, Arduinos or some other, or probably not FPGAs, but it might be PICs, who knows. But see, we got, looks like we got direct drive, multiplex display. Doesn't look like, yeah, because we don't have any dropping resistors. So looks like it's all current controlled, which I mean is smart, you know, you can cut down on the discrete components. In fact, I actually don't see many discrete components on here. A few resistors, capacitors, and the power supply. 7805 voltage regulator, pretty standard regulated linear supply. Got this is the battery backup here. I would think there'd be some active switching in here for the battery monitor. So there's a battery monitor leg, but yeah, it just looks like it's right there in parallel with it. I guess it just waits for a load, you know, just passive. There's not really like active switching here for the battery backup. It's just sitting there waiting for a load. I guess when the primary voltage drops out, then there would be a load on the other side of the diode. It would just start to, current would just start to flow. I guess that's just how they're doing it. A matrix of switches here. I guess those are the controls. 1, 2, 3, 4. Switches, looks like pull-up resistors. That's all logic stuff. Yeah, so it looks like we got a connector. So there must be two boards. Maybe they got the power supply on one board and the display on the other, but very simple schematic. Doesn't look like there's gonna be a whole lot to assemble, okay. So this is a pretty, nostalgia, because this is how it used to come in the old days, these little manila envelopes, which would have the components, so it's electronic components, hardware, tools and hardware, got displays and speaker. ICs, that's cool. Panels and the PCB, and this, I'm assuming this is a wall wart. Yep. Watch out, an adapter. It's a 9-volt AC, 1000 milliamps. Pretty hefty wall wart. All right. So I guess we're not going to have any. It's not going to have mains power fun like in the vintage ones. I take an ice cube tray. This is actually, I think, one of my original ones from the 80s, I think. But ice cube tray, when I learned to solder at Heathkit back in 78, the Heathkit guys were telling me that the best thing is just get an old ice cube tray so you can sort all the parts and hardware and stuff and just get it all sorted out and have them all on hand and, you know, they're right where you need them, and also it's easy to do counts and stuff, so that's what I plan to do. I plan to use the old ice cube tray method. Why not? I mean, we're doing nostalgia Heathkit build, right? So, yeah. So the first thing they're going to tell me to do, obviously, is to go through and inventory the parts. Oh. Well, this is kind of interesting. So I wonder if they're doing their own in-house publications, because looking at the very first sentence here, and it says, "What is an good electrical connection?" Question mark. Well, the very first sentence, "What is an good electrical connection?" Should be, "What is a good electrical connection?" Two metals, plural, objects have a good electrical connection when they securely contact each other. Two metals, objects. This is really weird. was this done in China? Or, to hold them together and let electricity flow from one part to another. Soldering is one way to make an electrical connection. Your Heathkit is a solder kit. It uses solder joints to hold parts in place and make electrical connections. You will need to make careful, proper solder joints for your kit to work properly. Well, that's all grammatically correct. It is important to develop a feel for when a screw is tight. A tightened screw is fully inserted and will not fall out on its own. If it has the nut is snug. Screws that attach a component should hold the components firmly in place, not crush them. So that's all grammatically correct. That first paragraph is really weird. I don't know. I guess they're not checking their own copy. Reading resistor codes. Got tools that I'll need. Pliers, nose, long nose, diagonal cutters, wire strippers, soldering iron, yada yada. Yeah, I got all that. Yeah, this all seems to be written correctly. I wonder, though, what parts were just kind of taken verbatim from old Heathkit assembly manuals, kind of just cut and paste the letter for letter. I'm not going to read all this because I know how to do all this, but showing soldering techniques, foil, soldering iron, yeah. Good solder connection, and bad solder connections. You don't want it to look like that. Making your work look professional. You always want it to look professional. Following suggestions will not necessarily improve the operation of your kit. They will, however, help you troubleshoot it if it ever becomes necessary, and help you perform checkout and test steps later in this manual. You will have a more professionally built kit when you finish. Well, you certainly want it to look good and have all those nice crisp bent leads and all that stuff. Solder bridges. Like a bridge over troubled solder. Solder bridges. Hey, these are lifted from old Heathkit manuals. I can pretty much guarantee, even without looking at it, that the tracks and traces aren't going to look like that on this board. They're not going to have that hand-laid, totally, analog thickness, single-sided, look. No, definitely not. Yep. Parts list. Here we go. For each assembly section, the instructions will identify one or more envelopes for you to work. So what I got to do is I got to open up the envelopes, go through the parts lists, and make sure that everything in here is actually in here. That would be the first order of business. And page 2. Okay, well, it's not too many parts. So I don't need the manual to tell me how to do this. So what I'm going to do is open up the envelopes and sort all the parts. Got a Maxim MAX 7219 CNG, date code 2016, and the other one here, it's a Heathkit branded 444-1001, but it's just got a little label on it. So let's see. Avoiding the warranty. It's an Atmel A-Tiny 84A, so Arduino? Atmel. and Maxim. So there you go. Yep. Already voided the warranty. All right. So let's see our displays and speaker. Oh, okay. I do not like two sockets, generally speaking, because they fail. Sockets fail. All the clocks like that I built in the past and like the early Heathkits and stuff, you know, the first thing I had to do after the pins all got tarnished was remove all the sockets and, you know, solder the chips directly to the boards. But we got ourselves a little speaker here, which I will very certainly never use. And I'm just going to pull those out. Probably use, I don't know, it's two sockets for those two chips, but these others, this looks like they want to socket the displays. I wouldn't ever do that. Yeah. That's what they're going to do somehow. Yeah. Yeah, we'll see exactly how much by the book we're going to do this, but I would not socket LED displays. I will very likely put them right on the board, but tools and hardware. Oh, I didn't want that to come open, that's for sure. Spacers, battery holder. Yeah, I don't know. I would never populate this. I would never have batteries in a clock necessarily. But yeah, I don't know. So obviously, I'll install it, but. Is that Velcro? Yeah, it's Velcro. What could we be using Velcro for? That's interesting. Okay, well, Velcro. All right. I got some sticky tape. Okay, let's... some blocks, kind of like this little block here, but that was spacers. It's a little, is that a foot? I guess that's a foot, it's a rubbery thing. I guess that's a foot. Another spacer. So what I'll do is, you know, sort the hardware by size. So like big screws, put big screws in one and tiny screws, put in another. And with washers, that's tiny screws. I've got more big screws. Those look like stainless. Those are probably outside. I'm going to use an Allen keyed screws. That's a nice touch. Make it nice, make it look nice and pretty. That's a big nut. Another block. All right. Some big spacers. Another block, big screws in there, little screws in there. It's kind of a medium screw. It's like a medium screw. Medium screws got their own little thing, I guess. It's a tiny screw. Another. I guess those are feet. Foot. Another block. Allen wrench, okay. Another one of those medium screws, little screw, washers, medium washer, okay. Two Allens, so, yep. It's nice, touch, putting the tools in there. And electronic components. So I guess I'm gonna put these back in the box, because these supplies I'm gonna put here. Big stuff I'll leave in the cardboard box. Oh, ribbon cable. That's interesting. I guess there are two boards. makes sense with that connector that's on the schematic. So ribbon cable. Got a nice big electrolytic here. It's a Vishay. I like the fact that it's the sort of the 70s style electrolytic, you know, nice axial. You don't see axial caps very much anymore. Yeah, kind of hard to find, actually. One big axial cap. Solder. Got some shrink tubing. Got a little button. I guess it's a little push button. Hardware. I guess I'll put that with the speaker. And we got a long neck push button. Okay. Put that with the stuff there. We got a tiny little... What is that little... It's like a light pipe. Yeah. It's kind of... Yeah, it's like some kind of lens or... I don't know. Put that there. We got a little amber LED there. T1 size. Diode. Put the diode in. All right, we got some more LEDs. Amber LEDs. Amber. Amber. More of those switches. All right. It's got a power jack. And heat sink. Put that with the ICs. And we got a 7805. Yep, indeeder. Put that with the ICs. Another switch. I've never really seen these sort of PCB mount switches with a really long neck on it like that before. It's kind of interesting. All right. Yep, got another cap. Caps off. Serious. Are those... Oh, these aren't tantalum. Oh, man. I hope those aren't... Yeah. They sure look like tantalum caps. I don't know. There's another little mini electrolytic. Was that a 10 mic? 10 mic. We got a cell. It's going to be for the light dimming, light sensing for brightness of the display. It's pretty cool. Put that in there. Another diode. Resistors. 1K to 10Ks. You know, when you work with resistors enough, you get to just identify the value just by looking at it. It's like, oh, that's a 10K. Oh, that's a 1K. That's 100. That's a 4.7K. What's whatever. But it's like, just sort of gets burned in your brain, the color combinations. And I certainly have looked at enough resistors in my life, believe me. You know, 2 decades of manufacturing. Some more little amber. I like the little amber LEDs. Amber is not really used that much in products, but it is actually among the more pleasant of LED colors. Not really used too much these days. So it's MPSA20 transistor. Put that with the ICs. There's another light pipe. I'll put that with the other one. So obviously with an LED. Another diode, more resistors. We got 100 ohm and 3 10Ks, so there's a lot of 10Ks in this. I guess those are all pull-up resistors. Looking at the schematic, it looked like there was a whole bunch of pull-up resistors for the switching matrix. Another diode, another cap. This guy's a 100 mic, 16 ohm, part of the power supply, obviously. We got ourselves another amber LED, 100 ohm resistor, a 10K and a 47K, 22K, another 10K, and it looks like a 47 ohm. That must be some kind of control. There's another switch. to say, I like the feel of these switches. It's actually very nice. I mean, usually these sorts of little PC switches aren't too clicky, but it's actually clickety. Put it up on the speaker. Two more little light pipes. Okay. Down with the LEDs. Another diode. There were four diodes in the power supply. And a bunch more 10K. So we have a lot of 10K resistors. And that is it. All right, so that's all the components. Pretty good, you know, one tray and got everything in there. And panels and PCB. Pre-applied labels. In the old days, you would put all the labels on. You get all the labeling and put it on yourself, but I guess they've skipped that. This is it's an acrylic sheet, but it's textured on one side. So looks like it's been B-blasted on one side, or maybe it's oh, okay. This is going to be hard because on one side, I'm going to have to cover that up. At least for the duration of my assembling this clock, I have to cover up the label that has the personalized link in it. But I don't know, it's acrylic, but it might be cell cast. But it seems like cell cast acrylic. Let's see here. Okay. Huh. Yeah, okay. Well, here's another piece of, looks like cell cast acrylic, but a couple blocks glued to it, and not too crisply. Take a look at that. That's not very Heathkit, I must say. That's not very Heathkit at all. Obviously these blocks are glued down, but very coarsely. It looks like it's been scored there, or I don't know. That's just not very Heathkit. I don't know, it's really smacks of Chinese work, Asian work, I don't know. All right, we got some labels and front panels. These are also acrylic. Is that cardboard? Yeah, it's paper. Some kind of printed paper, I guess, to go. I'm seeing that kind of lines up. So it looks like it's paper that you put behind acrylic. I guess this other side would be the other side. And I bet those are probably our light pipes, if I would venture to guess. I don't know, is that laser cut? I mean, that would make sense. I mean, that's really the way things are done now, laser cut. And I guess laser cutting, it would leave a really crisp, clean interior. It would kind of melt its way, you know, you wouldn't have any, like, tooling marks. Maybe it is just laser cut. And we got couple side pieces here. Wood. I don't know. Again, this isn't very Heathkit. And the finish is already marred right here. That's got kind of a deep gouge on what I'd see as the exterior. Well, you know, it's lacquered, stained lacquered wood, unknown type wood, and lastly, what everyone's been waiting for, including myself, the board. It's the board. Dun dun dun. Dun dun dun. It's the board. All right. Oh, I got it upside down. All the letters are gonna fall off. There we go. Is this two boards or one board? Okay, yeah, so there's a score. So I guess this is going to be a break board. I'm going to have to break those in half. So it's going to, there will be two boards. Yeah, but they made it in one. Well, this is obviously not American, I would think. White solder mask, two-sided board. Yep. Huh. Yeah, it's, they don't, I guess they're, so on the back side, they've got solder pads on all of the leads. On the front, solder pads on some. So, So, yeah, okay. See, again, see, it's like that. This board, they're got solder pads on all the pins, and then on the top side, just a few on that max. Okay. All right, well, yeah, standard power supply stuff. All right, extending the pin of the voltage regulator. Okay. So that other chip, that Atmel, must be for the alarm function, the multi-functions that they were talking about. Alright, oh, and there's copyright 2015. One board, but I guess that this is from 2015, that's from 2018. I guess they updated the control board. But alright, tiny boards, it's not as, this whole clock is not going to be that big. It's going to be tinier than the other clocks. Okay, I'm not going to make like a hour and a half long video of putting this together. I'm going to break it up into three parts. So I'll end part one with having everything sorted and everything unboxed and checked. So I'll come back for the next one with part two, which will be assembling the board and then final assembly and testing. I guess it'd be number three. We'll see how long it takes to do the board. Not a lot of components, so I might be able to just do like the whole assembly, maybe as one video. I don't know. Maybe a three-parter, maybe a two-parter. We'll just see how it goes. And hopefully everything will turn out fine. But all right. So here we go. This new adventure, new Heathkit. Yeah. Well, we'll just see how it goes. All right. I'll see you back here very soon for part two, and thanks to all my patrons over there on that there Patreon for making all these videos possible. Yeah, for making this Heathkit build possible. If you like what I do, if you like these kind of wacky videos, then consider becoming a patron. It's easy to do. You just follow the link in the description, become a patron. All right, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll see you for part two. Bye. That's where I work. In the lab. Go berserk. In my lab. Where I work. At the bench.